check and kicks off the leg. She checked with their Buntan.
Yeah, Jackie is extremely fast, especially when it comes to the counter shots. And we just saw a perfect example of that. She checked the kick and came right back with a beautiful little kick right to the midsection of Wonder Girl.
Fast hands there, nice thread of the left hook over the top of the right glove of Wonder Girl. Shorter stance, narrower stance on Wonder Girl, a little more flat-footed of the two. Skips in for an inside leg kick, and Buntan circles counterclockwise, staying away from the right side of Wonder Girl. Good lean back to evade the high kick there from Buntan. Fake from Buntan, trying to draw a reaction from Wonder Girl. Leans back again, just drifting out of the way of that right roundhouse. Comes in with a cross, then a hook, does Buntan. Shuffle forward, round kick to the ribs from Buntan. Nicely done off the lead leg, no switch.
That lead leg kick is landing to the body, but this is where Wonder Girl wants to be. She's got good hands inside when she gets close.
Yeah, keep in mind the height advantage that Wonder Girl has here, and Buntan's doing a great job of just staying right at distance, slipping those kicks, and avoiding all the damage.
Yeah, Wonder Girl's got to use that reach. She's got to start sticking that jab out just to make sure she gets at least the timing. Nice right left hand landed by Buntan.
That left hook continues to travel over the top of the right glove of Wonder Girl Fairtex. Got to be careful not to drop that right arm, Wonder Girl. And there it is. You see the low check and immediately the kick off the same leg from Buntan. Good skill set so far from Jackie Buntan. Three-punch combination, ends with the hook again looping behind the right glove.
It looks like Buntan's just a little bit faster than Wonder Girl in this opening stanza.
Nice just pull back to the leg.
Light speed advantage. See, look at those exchanges. You know, when Wonder Girl throws one or two, Buntan's throwing three or four.
You can definitely tell that Buntan trains alongside Janet Todd. There's a lot of similarities here. In the first round. The speed, the precision, the volume as well. Oh, smack bang! There's the left hook I spoke about. Again, over the top of the right glove. And Wonder Girl could be done here. That quarter clean. She can't continue.
Step forward. Your hand.
Ready? Wow, she may be saved in the final 10 seconds here. But she's not all there, Wonder Girl. The left hand quarter cleanly. Buntan may not have enough time to finish her.
Oh, yeah.
To Buntan. Little upcut on the inside there from Buntan, immediately out of danger, so she's not open to any counterattacks from Wonder Girl.
You can see the way Buntan paused at the rear hand of Wonder Girl, and it's kind of creates a slight opening where she's able to touch her up with the follow-up punches. So she clears that rear hand and then comes in with a flurry of shots.
Skipping inside thigh kick, good counter left hand again there from Buntan. Inside leg kick, skips up and under again. Nicely done, high to that femoral profunda.
Wonder Girl just doesn't have her legs underneath her. Her movement's stagnant, and Jackie is starting to unload. Look at that, going to the body with that straight right hand.
Her confidence is shot to at the moment, Wonder Girl. She really is a confident fighter, and there's no confidence at the moment because Buntan has been owning her. Buntan's so quick, so accurate, and so efficient with these strikes. No windmilling. No overextension, no going hell-bent for a knockout, choosing her moment to move in, land, and get out.
Yeah, she's able to move in and out, and then Wonder Girl's not making her pay for anything or anything. So basically, Jackie's able to come in, hit her combination, step back out, reset, come back in, hit the next combination, just like that, step back out, and now she's reset again.
Yeah, Wonder Girl looks lost at this point in time. You can see the similarities between Janet Todd and Jackie Buntan. They've been training together for a really long time. The stance is very similar, and just sort of the bounce and the cadence in their stance.
Janet Todd beat Stamp Fairtex. How would it be if Jackie Buntan beat Stamp's training partner, Wonder Girl Fairtex? There would be a rivalry created, wouldn't it? Janet and Jackie, Stamp and Wonder Girl. Good high check there from Wonder Girl. Drift back to center circle. 45 seconds to go in the second round. Another very good round. Switch up round kick there from Jackie Buntan. 10-8 opening round for Buntan. Drops the lead down to the body. Wonder Girl not connecting.
Yeah. She went to the body right there, and that's bringing Wonder Girl's arms down, and then came right back upstairs with that lead hook.
30 seconds left in the second round.
It is just excellent. It's flawless so far from Jackie Buntan. Wonder Girl has no answers. Inside leg kick, crossing elbow from Wonder Girl, but can't stay at that close range. Again, she's back to the range that Buntan wants.
Yeah, that's what she needs to be doing, though, on the inside there. That's, if I was going to pick an exchange that was the best exchange for Wonder Girl, it was that one. It was the dirty one that she had right there.
But she can't stay there after she's done, because that's when her hands start to drop just a little bit. She's entering the third round and final. She's got to do some serious work here. She's still got it. You know, she still carries that power in her hands to stop any female, but she's got to do it right now. She cannot wait any longer.
Left hook again, causing problems. It was established in the opening round very early. It caused the knockdown in the opening round, and it is still pressuring and tormenting Wonder Girl here in the final round. Takes the leg out of the way there. Nicely done from Buntan. She is reading so much of what Wonder Girl is attempting to throw at her.
Yeah, she's almost thinking ahead of time. She knows what Wonder Girl's doing, because Wonder Girl's not setting anything up. Like with that leg kick, that was a naked leg kick. There wasn't any hands in front of it, and she just threw the leg kick, and it was easy for Buntan to step out of the way.
And again, you see Wonder Girl is stuck at this kickboxing distance on the outside, not able to get inside and really turn it into a Muay Thai contest.
I tell you, those last two combinations by Jackie, I'm really impressed at her speed. She's able to get in, throw one or two to three piece combinations, and then slide out before Wonder Girl's even able to counter.
Accept!
Flush of leg kicks, it was Wonder Girl who drew the short straw. Gained double hook lead hand from Buntan. Been prime weapon for her.
You can see how she loads up those kicks. She's trying to set up those big roundhouse kicks because she's looking for it.
We aren't seeing the straight line punching that so characterized the previous two ONE Super Series matches of Wonder Girl Fairtex. That knockdown in the first round, it rattled her, and I think it's still rattling her mentally. Again, Jackie quick, look at these combinations, and gets out of the way of the counter right hand.
Man, they are doing some good work over at Boxing Works with Coach Brian. I'm just seeing so much high level striking coming from Jackie Buntan right now.
I'll tell you what, guys, if I had my eyes shut right now, I would think I was listening to a heavyweight match based on the way these leather is landing.
Yeah, you can see Wonder Girl starting to blink more profusely, just trying to get the clearer vision.
That left eye
touched up.
Under 30 seconds remaining in the contest now. Complete ownership from Jackie Buntan. It's been a delight to watch. Constantly circling away from the right side of Wonder Girl Fairtex, getting in, landing, getting out. Keeping this one as a kickboxing contest. They haven't engaged in the clinch. I think they've been clinched up maybe twice. And certainly when they were clinched up, Wonder Girl got off some strikes, got off some knees, threatened with an elbow, but she hasn't been able to get back there. And that's been a big problem. That's another 10-9 round of
Jackie Buntan!
The party. Nice straight line punches early on from Victoria. Towers over her by 11 centimeters, right hand to the jaw. Chin very high on Sunisa, not tucking it. Two-punch combination.
Nice little straight punches landed by Victoria, but this is where she excels. She's good inside that clinch. She's a Hawaiian State Wrestling champion. She's got really good grappling. Look for the head snap and possibly gonna threaten a anaconda or a front headlock choke.
Saw Sunisa use the knees to the midsection against Rika Ishige. Muay Thai clinch here from Sunisa. Locks it on again. Trying to control the head, but the body will follow.
Sunisa's got to be careful here. Yep, she snaps her down. This is where she's going to start looking for that choke. Good job by Sunisa to keep her head out of danger. Now Sunisa's attempting possibly a head and arm throw.
72% of fans of the ONE Super App keeping a win for Victoria Lee.
Sunisa putting her down with that head and arm throw now. Immediately, Victoria's trying to transition into a possible inverted triangle. She's looking for it, but Sunisa's wise to it, keeping her head buried. Now Victoria's got a very active guard.
Nice. Nicely done from Sunisa, back to her feet. Drifting towards center circle now.
As Victoria was on the up, you can see Sunisa timed it beautifully with that head kick.
Hooking right hand there from Sunisa. Again, hooking punches from the Thai on the back foot now.
Sunisa's got to keep her guard a little bit tighter. Those straight punches of Victoria are getting through, but the aggression from Sunisa is starting to score and land.
High check there from Victoria off the leg kick. Flipping right hand from Sunisa, nicely done to the jaw, drift away, fade away, hook off the right hand. Ties her up against the fence here. Hooks the leg, does Victoria.
Again, Sunisa's trying for that head and arm throw. Victoria's defending well and just tosses her down.
Ground and pound now from Victoria, looking at it. Secure the back of Sunisa Season. Approaching the halfway point of this opening round on debut for 16-year-old Victoria Lee.
Good job by Victoria to secure the back. Let's see if
the back of the head.
She can defend. She's trying to defend, trying to tie up those arms. But as she did that,
hooks her
Victoria
in.
Victoria used that to get the second hook in, trying to flatten her out. Sunisa's got to protect the neck.
Sunisa could be in trouble now. Is this the beginning of the end? And Victoria going to loosen her up, soften her up a little more. 2:10 remains, still a long time to go in the opening round. And it's Victoria Lee in control.
Bad spot for Sunisa. She's got to, you can see she's trying to stay nice and tight with the hands, trying to close in so Victoria can't pop her hands out because that's what she was scared of. She's got to try to turn into her, but Victoria is able to get an underhook on her left side to prevent her from spinning.
Sunisa still looking composed, trying to avoid the choke here. Hooks in from Victoria Lee.
Yeah, but as she lets go of the hand, she's giving Victoria the opportunity to slide that arm right underneath the neck. Now the right arm of Victoria Lee is underneath the neck of Sunisa. Sunisa needs to defend the choke because here it comes.
Here it comes from Victoria Lee. Flips her up like a pancake. Is this it?
No touch.
No, got to reset here. Victoria, soften her up a little more. Here come the elbows. Sunisa surviving. 1:15 remains in the first. What can Sunisa do to get out of this predicament, Dragon?
Well, the first thing she has to do is she has to protect her neck. That's step one. Once she has the hands protected, but you can see the right hand is starting to come underneath. She's got to be very careful here. Now, good switch by Victoria. She's threatened with the left, but now she's going back to the right. Good job by Sunisa, but Victoria chooses to change the game plan and punch.
Raining down the punches now from the back is Victoria Lee, referee right on top of the action. And Sunisa survived the onslaught here. Victoria trying everything to finish the resilient tie. 35 seconds to go in the round. Switches to the right hand, Victoria. Drops them down.
30 seconds left.
Referee keeping a close eye on Sunisa, making sure she still defends.
Sunisa's tough, man. She's hanging in there. She took a lot of shots, but she was able to defend the key ones and not allow them to threaten her. This is a lot longer than a lot of people thought it was gonna go. But Sunisa is hanging in there.
If she can make it out of the round, it'll be a tremendous confidence booster to Sunisa's Season, the Thunderstorm. And indeed she has made it into the second round. Second round, Victoria Lee's mixed martial arts pro debut against Sunisa's Season. Right hand from Season, another right hand there. Victoria, good snappy jab, eats a right. Trying to work her way into a clinch here, Victoria. Step through knee, good crossing right hand from Victoria.
Sunisa needs to keep her punches a little bit tighter. She's got these looping punches that are coming in at angles, and that's allowing Victoria to come right through the middle. But she is connecting, though. She's got to move, though. She can't stand there with her back up against the circle wall. She's got to circle out, because this is what Victoria likes to do. Likes to get into that tight clinch and start throwing those knees.
Sunisa comfortable also in the Muay Thai clinch. Crossing elbow, nicely done out of the clinch way. Sunisa, who was actually born in Laos and later moved to Thailand at age 8, became a Thai national. Now giving her back to Victoria Lee. Such a position Victoria was in for much of the first round. And she's got her! She's got her! Feel the energy between these two, Dragon, and a takedown there from Jared Brooks.
Yep, Brooks was able to utilize that energy, Michael, to put Lito Adiwan on his back. Now it's important for Lito to keep moving. She's got an overhook on Jared's left arm. Let's see what he can do with it. He might be trying to transition into an omoplata, which is a shoulder lock. But Brooks, he says he's been working a lot with Brazilian jiu-jitsu athletes, really fine-tuning his submission game and submission defense to make sure none of these submissions that Adiwan's going to threaten with are going to become a problem. I like the overhook by Lito Adiwan. Big takedown.
Beautifully done there from Jared Brooks. A second takedown from the American inside the first minute. Close guard here from Lito.
Brooks is strong, easily picks up Lito Adiwan because of that overhook on the right side of Lito Adiwan. Let's see what Lito can do with this. He's got to create a little bit more movement, maybe abandon that overhook and create some movement up against that wall. Put his feet on the hips and start working away. This is not a good spot to be in against Jared Brooks. Jared Brooks has a very aggressive ground and pound game. He might be looking to punch his way past the guard and then look for a finish.
Gets the arm out, drops an elbow to the orbital there. Does Jared Brooks another one? Forearms raking across the mandible now of Adiwan. You can hear Jared grunting behind these strikes.
Good frame there. You can see how he's framing off the arm to keep control so he can deliver the elbows. That's a good way to deliver ground and pound without really breaking your posture. He's staying nice and tight, not allowing Lito to create a lot of movement. You can see Lito's trying to get a possible butterfly hook with his right leg, but Jared shut that down with his knee positioning. See, you can see what Lito's trying to do. He's trying to get his right leg underneath the leg of Jared to create possibly a sweep or at least some elevation on the hips. But Jared is wise to it, and he's keeping his knees exactly where he needs to be to eliminate that. A lot of experience on the grappling side coming from Jared Brooks right now.
What would they be telling Lito to do right here, Dragon?
You can see he was trying to get his back up against the wall, right? So that's good because he can use the wall to work his way back up. But just as he tried to do that, Jared turned him to his right and put him flat on the mat. Jared just smothers people.
So fast and precise with the elbows. Jared Brooks tries to curl in the right knuckles now. Switches to the left hand. And with every strike he throws, you hear that ki eye from Jared Brooks.
Nice elbow.
The corner applauding the elbows of Jared Brooks. Cracks another one to the side of the head. Just measuring Lito Adiwan. Brooks trying to open up a place in the top five and take Lito out of there. Lito appearing in the top five for the first time.
Yeah, Jared Brooks is bringing a wrestling pedigree into one championship that not a lot of strawweights have seen. He's an Indiana State wrestling champion. So he is a high-level grappler, and this game is something that a lot of the strawweights are going to have to deal with, getting taken down and then getting beat on from this position. Adiwan is very explosive. He's doing right, a good job by putting his feet on the hips to create that movement, but Jared was all over him. Now Lito is going to try to use that wall, try to utilize that post. You can see Jared's trying to suck the arm away to eliminate that post and drive him back to the ground, but Lito did a great job of getting back up.
Lito breaks off and now he's from distance to work the strikes. He barks at Jared and sends him back with a nice kick off the right leg.
He's like, I did it.
35 seconds to go in the first round. It's been a good opening round for Brooks, but Lito can do some damage if he can land the strikes. The uppercut from the Thunder Kid, nicely done. He stuck him with it.
Oh, that uppercut. That uppercut, Michael. He's also got a big left hook. Jared knows just how dangerous Lito Adiwan is, especially when he closes that distance to look for that takedown. He's got beautiful uppercuts and awesome, dynamic, explosive hooks.
Final 10 seconds. Adiwan measuring the right hand again here. It's the high right.
Nice.
I like the counter right hand. Shoots in for a takedown. Sprawls out as Lito.
That shot was from a really long ways away, but it seemed like it was such a long shot. He was still able to slide in.
It was like he was on a water slide.
Yeah, like a slip and slide right into the double leg. And he was able to suck those legs in. Lito's got to work his way back up. He does not want to sit around here and play. He had his back against the wall, but Brooks slid his hips away to keep him flat on the mat. This is what Adi Wan said he wanted to do. He said he wanted to throw elbows and hammer fists if he was on the bottom. But the way that Brooks has him pressed up against the cage, it's hard for Adi Wan to create the space and to really start delivering strikes that land with any sort of impact.
You know, Mitch, we saw Alex Silva earlier on, and we'll talk about the BJJ prowess of Silva and how he works to tap you out. But it's got to be just so physically depleting to have a wrestler of this high caliber on top of you, grinding away like Brooks is doing on Lito Adawan.
Yeah, it's
a completely different form of punishment.
It's debilitating and it's also demoralizing when you're trying everything that you've used in training to get up, and it's worked, and it's just failing you in competition. And you can see how he's trying to create the little angles with his legs, like he's trying to put his legs into position, trying to get his feet on the hips, trying to create butterfly hooks. See, he was trying right there. Now he's got it. Jared's trying to step over that right now. This is where Adi Wan could possibly create a little bit of movement. He tried to switch over, but Jared's just so good at controlling the hips. Right, the way that he's able to distribute weight and sort of just ride what Adi Wan is doing, it's really hard to deal with.
Can Lito possibly find a way back to his feet? Yes, he can.
But he gets jumped on. Immediately, Brooks jumps on the neck as Adi Wan works his way back up to the feet. Now he's just hanging there.
That's got to take a toll on the neck of Lito Adi Wan. Some knees now from Brooks. Leg kick from Lito. And he gets some distance.
If he slips up, pull that back to your level change.
Give me the nuts.
Oh, this is relaxed, man.
All right, let's go.
And we're back home. Shoots down for a double.
Nice level change there, thrown by Jared Brooks as he drops down, attacks the
legs. Boom, shakalaka. Nicely done from Jared again.
Picks him up, puts him down, and immediately triangles the leg and works his way into mount. That's high-level grappling right there, Michael. Steps over. Adi Wan's going to try to do something, but gives up an arm triangle in the process.
Catch.
Now Brooks is going to drive his shoulder basically into the neck and arm of Lito Adi Wan. Lito Adi Wan.
He taps out. It's good night, Irene.
Southpaw stance on Taewon Chai. Orthodox on Clubber Clancy.
Well, those matches that you were speaking about with Kulab Dom were decision wins, and it's just beautiful technical precision, just like that. He's just able to figure out what you're doing and then come up with a counter for it. Sean needs to go forward and disrupt him right now.
Clancy cannot stay on his line against Taewon Chai. Taewon Chai will pick him off. And I agree, Mitch, like I said, you've got to go for it. Got to go for it early. Crossing elbow there from Taewon Chai. First we've seen outside leg kick from Clubber.
Man, I cringed when that leg kick landed, or the head kick landed. You can already see the hematoma on the side of Sean Clancy's head there. And he shook that off, just like Mitch said, sirloin, truck stop.
High right roundhouse kick there from Clubber, caught on the double forearms guard. Catch and sweep counter, couldn't execute the sweep, two-punch combination over the top. Trying to measure with the lead hand there, Clubber Clancy resets, thought about the front kick. Teep off the back leg, out of southpaw stance from Taewon Chai. Cracks the back leg, goes up to the head.
He's so fast with those kicks, man, and the way that he does it, there's almost no tell whatsoever.
Drops him with the left hand. I think you just popped him on the chin with that left hand, and Clubber went down.
Seven.
You cannot stand in front of Taewon Chai. He will tee off on you like a golf course. Three knockdowns in one round. Don't forget, it will be over. Uppercut to left cross.
Clancy can't stand in front of Taewon Chai. Look at that kick. Just precision.
He's got to go circular. He's got to go lateral. He's just staying in front of Taewon Chai. It's a recipe for disaster. Jab two. Get off the fence here, Clubber Clancy. You've got to move. But look at Taewon Chai. Nothing phasing him. Just relaxed.
can see Clancy's only moving forward and back. He's got to start moving laterally, and especially away from that left kick.
It'll be interesting to look at the punch stats at the end of this match, because everything, I feel like Talon Chai has a 100% strike landing rate.
I don't disagree. Everything off his left side so far is just superb. We're seeing the elbows, the high kicks, we're seeing the straight lift cross. This is a show, this is a performance. Oh, clubs Clubber with that right hand. And Clubber's face is a horror story. Another high lift rally kick from Talon. Unofficially, but you can't give it any other way. First round for Talon Chai.
Look how relaxed Talon Chai is, composed and just... He's walking through Central Park on a Sunday afternoon.
He's having a coffee, he's strolling along, he's waving to people, saying hello to his mates. I mean, this is just incredible.
He's got a world champion standing in front of him. Look at that nice little step through to the right hand.
The hematoma, the cut, the left eye's closing a little now for Sean Clancy.
Yeah, you know, Chevelle, you talk about Sean Clancy using that footwork to move. I don't believe that he has the footwork to outmaneuver Talon Chai. Maybe he should look at clinch work here or something, tying him up just so Talon Chai can't tee off on him.
Left-hand lead there from Talon Chai. Clancy goes upstairs, cannot just throw the singles though. Got to use combinations here. Got to find a way to try and frustrate, land something on Talon Chai.
You can see another hematoma on the outside of the jaw right there of Sean Clancy.
The right hand was there for the asking, didn't take it though, and look at the return from Talon Chai.
This is a four or five piece combination, every single one of them landed.
And it all started with that jab. That right jab just comes. Look at that thing. It's a sledgehammer. Just pops him right in the chin over and over again. He can do it off the back foot, too. He's moving backwards and he's throwing shots.
Uppercut elbow. This is more like it. Maybe you heard you, Rich, trying the clinch work now. Clubber Clancy. Chance for the knees from the Irishman. He's been more active on the inside in the clinch, and maybe it'll give him a slight boost of confidence. Not a drop of sweat on Talon Chai. Not a crease of concern on the 21-year-old's face.
What I really like about Talon Chai's style is that he's just very patient with everything that he throws. There's no rush for him. Even when he has somebody wobbled, he still follows up very patiently, and everything is just with precision.
It's also the efficiency of the striking. Everything is thrown to land. There are no wasted shots. Spinning back elbow to the side of the jaw. Two-punch combo there.
I know we speak a lot about accuracy, but this is the definition of striking accuracy. Every single shot he throws and initiates, he lands.
And guys, you don't see the downward elbow a lot in Muay Thai these days. You just don't see it. And here we see Talon Chai ripping out the jumping downward elbows, trying to crack the top of the head, the headache maker, trying to crack the clavicle of Clancy.
10 seconds.
You can see why he's so scary. You can see why everyone fears meeting Talon Chai inside the ring, inside the circle.
I think in the first round...
You know, Mitch, you talked about how Sean may have underestimated Talon Chai's power at the beginning of this match. I think if I walk past Talon Chai down the street, I would completely underestimate him as being the fighter that he is.
Rear hook there from Clubber Clancy. Talon Chai with the elbow off the lead arm.
I like how he changes stances when he throws that right hand. He comes forward, changes stances, and lands!
Bang! The big kibosh! Anderson, well, he predicted a knockout. Bushesha looks for the takedown early and gets it. Not where Silver wants to be. On his back with a BJJ 17-time world champion on top of him.
Beautiful job to reap the outside leg, and now he's pretty much in full mount. Braddock Silva's got to be very careful. He does not want to hold the head like this. This could give up that possible armbar. You can see the way that Buchecha is circling the head away from the wall so that Silva cannot back himself up and use the wall to get back up. You can see he's just trying to hold the head. Buchecha could just push the arms off and take full mount. You can see how he's framing off the face now. Sits himself up. And Braddock Silva goes to the body lock. He needs to let go of that body lock and start pushing down on the hips and to create a scramble to get some movement, because this is a bad spot to be in for Silva.
Defend yourself, Lou.
Measured elbows to the side of the head from Buchecha.
Anderson Silva must find a way back to his feet, and he's got to do it soon, because down here on the ground, it's Buchecheville, and he can just dismantle Silva in so many ways.
You can see that left arm that Buchecheville's got on his side right there. There's an arm triangle now. He might be able to jump over to the side if he clears that leg. You can see Silva's kind of panicking right here. He's not really fully adjusted to being on the ground.
Wouldn't you be panicked if you had a 17-time BJJ world champion doing this to you?
I would. I cannot hold that against him. I can't. But he's got to be a little bit more sound and a little bit more careful not to make these kind of mistakes. Because right now he's got basically three-quarter mount for Buchecha. You can see how he has a little bit of a half guard right there on one side. It's basically just a full mount for Buchecha. He's calm, he's composed, he's not rushing anything. This is what I wanted to see. I want to see how he utilizes the ground and pound for his BJJ game. He's got such good control. Beautiful step over there. The side control, I like the way he used his right arm to block the leg. So Silva couldn't try to get back into half guard, but now he's in north-south.
Look at the trajectory on these knees. He is getting airborne with those right knees to the side of the head and the collarbone of Anderson Silva. Now switches to the other side. Buchecha employing the full rule set here.
Looks like he could be going for a north-south choke. He's going to drive his right side, his pec, and his lat into the neck of. He's got one arm doing it. That might be it.
Is Anderson Silva going to tap out?
Nope.
Says no.
It's a hard choke to get.
He gave the Hulk Hogan finger wave. Not yet. Not tapping out yet, not going to sleep. 2:10 remaining. It's a long time to survive on the ground with Marcus Almeida. And now he taps. It's good night, Irene.
A, because of his flexibility. B, because when he actually sinks a choke on his opponent, he hisses. Outside leg kick from Ok. Ok wanting to break into that top five.
Yeah, and this is the express lane to get into the top five by taking out the former featherweight king, Murat Gafarov. Ok's got dynamic leg kicks, and he's also got a really nice right hand, which he was just able to land right there.
I'm so used to seeing Murat Gafarov as the taller opponent in a fight. And now that he's moved up to this weight class, and particularly in this match, you can see how much taller Ok is than him. And he's having trouble dealing with this range, this lengthiness.
He's in nice and tight here on a double leg. He transfers up to the hip. This is where Murat Gafarov likes to be. He's very strong inside that clinch, and he utilizes the wall very well.
Gafarov, as we said, who was such a dominant featherweight champion for so long before he was undone by Martin Nguyen's overhand right.
I like the way Ok is utilizing that overhook just to keep Murat Gafarov away from locking his hands, but Gafarov was still able to muscle him down as he's landing some good ground and pound, and he jumps on the back. This is the first step in that rear naked choke.
You know, it was the wizard that Ok was using to defend that takedown that ended up becoming the very thing that he couldn't use his arm to protect his head, and that's what it kept him exposed initially for Murat to land these punches.
Ok is backpacking him at the moment. Gafarov punching the side of the head. Ok forced to cover up.
The winner of this one gets Eddie Alvarez next week on One on TNT4.
He's definitely added a lot of muscle to his frame since moving up to lightweight. But he's also got that squeeze, too. He's got the body triangle around Ok, and he's just applying that squeeze. So it's also going to take a little bit out of Ok, too, to stand there and hold him.
Watch out, look over your head. Last warning.
Last warning from Olivia Cost not to strike the back of the head. We saw that a couple of weeks ago, of course, with Eddie Alvarez disqualified in his match on One on TNT, one against Yuri Lapagus. Must strike the ear or forward.
But what he's trying to do with those strikes to the side of the head is get Ok to pop his head up so he can do this. So he can take his left arm, slide it underneath the chin of Ok, and go for that squeeze. Murat Gafarov has got a nasty squeeze. I know he's called the Cobra, but he could be called the Boa Constrictor.
Is he going to get it?
What he's doing right here, it's not just the choke you have to worry about. He's coming across in that cross face and using that forearm on Ok's chin and jawline. And this stuff, with that kind of squeezing power that Murat Gafarov has, you could actually tap somebody from a neck crank or just pure pain at his skill level.
Got to soften him up a little more. Don't forget, folks, later on tonight on TNT at 10 p.m. Eastern, Hands of Stone John Lineker takes on the USA's Troy Worth, and that is going to be a rip snorter. Still Gafarov riding the back of Ok here. How much will this take out of the gas tank of Ok having to carry Gafarov this long, Rich?
It does. It takes a lot out of the legs. And I'll say this, though. You know, Murat is also using some gas here by holding on, but this is what Murat does, and he also has the body triangle locked in. You can see the leg across the seat belt there. And so he's using a lot less energy, but you can hear Ok on camera right now just how heavy he's breathing.
But I would imagine that maybe Ok would want to turn around and put Gafarov up against the wall just so he can alleviate some of that pressure from using, instead of carrying him, he could kind of use the leverage of the wall to just take away some of the pressure from his legs.
That's what I would do.
Because not only
softens him a little more, just tucks it under the armpit with those right hands.
Not only is it hard to stand there, but he's also got such a squeeze with that body triangle. It's going to make it harder and harder to breathe. And fatigue is going to be such a factor when we hit the 6 minute of this match.
30 seconds left in the first round.
I will say this, though. You see how Gafarov's foot is extended behind the crook of the knee there? He's got to be careful. I actually held a triangle one time in a match a little too long, and my ankle was trashed because I didn't have it locked in upright the way that it should. And so the ankle was extended, causing a lot of fatigue in just that one joint.
It's also hard to hold the body triangle when you're standing up. When you're on the ground, it's a little bit easier, but he chooses to let it go. And end the...
Jab two, leg took there, nice combination. Another combo down the center corridor, there's a knee! Beautifully done.
Yeah, Oka's a really nice long range striker. That was a beautiful 1-2 that he was able to land. But when he enters the pocket, when he throws those shots, he's closing the distance very fast. And it enabled Gafarov to tie him up, lock him up, and put him up against the side of the wall here. Oka's going back to that whizzer, and it looks like we're almost repeating what we did in the first round.
Corking knees here from Gafarov to the inside left thigh of Ok. Nice knee to the midsection there.
Looks like it is. Could have been a little low, the expression on Oak's face, but Olivier Koss chooses to keep them in this position.
Ok trying to enter that top five where the champion is Christian Leand. You know, you look at that and you say, wow, what do you have to do to beat Christian Lee? Who can beat Christian Lee after he's just disposing of people so easily lately? Timofey Nastukin last week in one round, Yuri Lapikus in one round, the way he dismantled Dagi in Tokyo. I mean, Christian Lee just running through absolutely everybody without raising a sweat. Reverse elbows here from Ok.
The only person in the top five that Christian Lee hasn't taken out is Murat Gafarov.
True, he's got Shinya Aoki to win the title. Was that second round, I think, against Aoki? TKO, just amazing. 22 years old, the champ, as you saw last week on TNT. You
know, this is another position for Murat Gafarov that's going to utilize a lot of energy because he has to keep that pressure on Ok to keep him against the cage. Like, even though his legs are straight here, this is just a lot of energy for your legs to just hold this isometrically the whole time.
What's Gafarov working for here, Dragon?
He's trying to get that double leg takedown. You can see he's got his hands around the legs of Ok, but Ok's doing a good job of pushing the head down and controlling the head position with his hand and his hips, not allowing Murat Gafarov to lock his hands, which is going to give him better control, but also just controlling his hips in such a way where he can do stuff like this. Now Gafarov changes his tactics, goes after one leg, but might give up his back in the process.
Friends.
Let's see if Ok here can transition to the back, but Murat Gafarov's holding Ok's left leg, and that's able to keep him into the position that he wants. Murat Gafarov's got to be careful because there's a possible triangle here because he's got one arm in and one arm out.
Ok only has one submission on his record, 12 for Murat Gafarov.
Yep, there's the triangle. Ok was able to slide his left leg away from the leg of Murat Gafarov. Now he's got that arm trapped, might transition to an omoplata, but goes back into full guard.
You know what's interesting about that, Mitch, is that the fact that I think Murat believed that Uck was not going to be able to triangle him, but because he got lazy with that and Uck was able to throw that triangle up, he ended up taking four or five shots to the head there. Just small hammer fists, but those little things add up.
80 seconds remain, second round of three in this lightweight contest. That's interesting, Mitch, that you said that, you know, about Christian having cleaned out the entire top five except Marat Gafarov.
Well, now Ok's here. He's got another triangle attempt.
There's a whistle for Ok to put him here inside the top five.
He has to. It has to, right? But he's got those long legs, so it's even easier to threaten these positions off of your back, and he's got very agile legs. I was just able to throw him up, attack these triangles, but he's only got half the triangle. He just has the legs locked. He's threatening the triangle now. He needs to take one of his legs and essentially pull the foot down into the knee. You can see him. He's trying to make that adjustment. See how he's trying to reach up there and grab his foot? He's trying to pull his foot into the joint of his knee and his leg.
I think this is beautiful what he's doing right here. See him stretching out his body, and then he's using his knees to pull. He knows that he can't break Murat Gafarov down for the triangle, so he's using his knees to pull Gafarov into these hammer strikes.
10 seconds.
Final 10 seconds of this round. Close guard here from Ok. Gafarov, top position. Been some impressive stuff, though, from Ok.
Time.
Spent on Ok's back in the first round, and the shots that he was landing to the face. But this is I'm talking a very marginal lead. This is anybody's match. And I believe that the momentum is headed in Ok's direction.
Looks like Gafarov is trying to bait Ok into a clinch position. He's backing himself up, almost willing, you know, Ok to enter into the clinch so he can get a hold of him.
Okay. Being patient, though, is Ok. Does not want to be baited into any of Gafarov's traps. Gafarov is almost looks like he's at a standstill here.
He's trying to get Ok to get close enough to him so that he can get at least a body lock on him so he can get this thing back down to the ground. This is Ok's opportunity right now. Nice left hook landed by Ok.
Inside leg kick from Gafarov. It takes a lot of effort, though. Let's see if Ok can capitalize now with those long arms, those long legs. And there he does, straight right hand through the guard. Overhand right to a left, sloppy on the left though. Kick to the outside of the knee. Another one there from Ok. You feel that Gafarov may be right for the picking with a good one too.
Gafarov's tough. He's eating a lot of these shots. I think it's going to take a lot more than just a 1-2 to put him away. He's going to have several of them. But this is what he wants. He wants to get nice and tight. Oh, nice little back take right there. Let's see what Ok can do. Smart of Ok to put his back up against the wall to defend the back take.
Approaching the halfway mark of this third and final round.
It was definitely looking like minutes 10 through 12 were swinging in Ok's favor, but this is what Gafarov does so well. He leans on that championship experience that he's got. He's got his left hands locked. Let's see if he can pull Ok away and possibly score another takedown.
What does Ok do from here, Dragon?
Well, he's got one arm in. See how his arm is trapped there? He can try to use that arm to pull Gafarov up. But look how Gafarov is leaning into him like that. He's applying a lot of pressure. Ok's got to sprawl heavy and keep his legs separated. See how Gafarov's grabbing his left foot like that so he can try to do something with it? But a great job by Ok with takedown defense. And this is going to score.
You can hear the heavy breathing of Marat Gafarov. Double leg. Gafarov
I love the way Ok is pushing Marat Gafarov's head down. He's going to push the head down. He's also, he should be starting to, right there. He's looping under the arm. But I don't think that, because Marat Gafarov is grabbing his ankle right there with his left arm, but he let go of it. I think Ok knew that that wasn't any kind of a threat. But
elbow there to the side of the head from Ok.
Almost didn't control the hips, and Ok was able to bounce right back up. What do you think, Rich? Aggression or takedown defense here?
Takedown defense for sure. These are great takedown attempts by Gafarov, and he's chain wrestling. He's going from one to the next to the next, but Ok is just doing a great job. He's working that wizard there again. You can see the right arm looped over. He's pulling it back now, but doing a great job. But once again, this is Gafarov. This is his territory, and he's got under a minute now to make this thing work by getting the back. This is going to be his last chance.
But this is going to score as well. That's ground control to take your back like that. That's
are they on the good. Ground, Mitch? Are they on the ground?
But it's a
30 seconds left.
Technicality, Dragon. Oh, the back is on again. Time may be against Gafarov to finish Ok. 20 seconds to go. Gafarov hunting for win number 19. Ok for win number 14.
Oh, beautiful job by Ok to pop his head out and sneak around the backside. It looks like Gafarov's going for a Kimura here. He used it as a sweep. He rolls onto his back. He's trying. Oh, good defense by Ok.
Great way to spin around.
Ok Rae Yoon! To the outside, Machado in southpaw stance. There's the right hand from Mulligan early. Round kick from Mulligan off the back leg.
Mulligan is pretty much known as a wrestler, but he's also been working really hard on his striking. He wants to put that on display here tonight. Good forward pressure so far.
Big leg kick from Machado, nicely done. Turned the leg a little too. Forced down there from Mulligan. Looks to take the back of the Brazilian. Done so now. Back up on his feet. Is Machado.
That was a nice snap down to take his back from the front headlock. Machado shot in, and Mulligan did a beautiful job of taking the back.
Still haven't scored this as a takedown because he's back to his feet now, so he never actually secured position on the ground.
Corking knee to the outside right thigh from Mulligan. Undefeated 8-0, 100% finishing rate for the Russian.
Mulligan just dragged him to the ground, but a sweep attempt right here by Bebezon as he's trying to walk the wall to reverse the position. But good balance so far showcased by Mulligan as he's dropping punches between his legs.
I think that's the first time I've ever seen that.
Ingenious. I'm not even going to try and label it, but it's ingenious. Side control here for the big hulking Russian. 2021, the year of the heavyweights in one championship. Amir Ali Akbari, the monster from Iran, up next against Kang Jiwon. And you know, watching this one closely, will be the world's champion, Brandon Vera, who everybody is gunning for this year.
He's got that crucifix position. This is a bad spot for Machado to be in. See how he's got the arm trapped there between the legs, and he's got an underhook on that far arm.
Yeah, he's doing a great job right there on his left hip with the pressure on Machado's chest. It's his topside pressure, Malikin's topside pressure.
There's an Americana.
Can he find a submission on that far arm of Machado? Still a long time to go. 2:45 remaining. First round of three. Both promised it won't go
defend
that far.
Yourself, Red.
And driving down, turning the knuckles off the right hand to the forehead of Machado. A hapless Machado, a trapped Machado. Nowhere to go, being held hostage in this position by Mulligan the Russian.
Yeah, he's got to try to work his way out of this, because it's going to be hard for Mulligan to secure this Americana. He might be able to get it, but I think this is the ground and pound, and getting the referee to stop it is his best way to victory.
Can the wrestler submit the BJJ black belt? Side of the head open again. The dome of Machado taking punishment off the big bear paw of a right hand of Mulligan.
Man, it sounds defend like Mulligan is generating some power with these shots. It's a very awkward position, and it's hard to really hurt, but
defend yourself,
hear that thump?
You can start to see the damage accumulating on Machado's face. So heavy or not, it's coming in. This topside pressure still, it's crazy.
Defend yourself, Red!
Keep it up front, Judge, keep it up front!
You can hear the sound of the leather pulverizing the head there of Machado.
Stop!
And there it is. Just hammering away relentlessly. There's the ballroom dancing now, we see it.
I stand corrected.
30% knockouts for Zhang Liping. Look out for the wushu striking on Flyang. The leg kicks, the cutting side kicks, the short, rapid hands, and the turning back kicks to the thigh, to the midsection. Front kick there from Zhang.
I like how Edwards utilizing those leg kicks early, but you can see how Zhang's trying to put that pressure on him. He's got the center of the circle. Let's see if Edwards just keeps hammering on those leg kicks to keep that distance.
7-2-1 in his last 10 for Zhang Liping. Comes here with huge wraps. The man born in Inner Mongolia, now based out of Foshan, China. Body shot nicely done there from Edward. Zhang tries to pick him up and slam him to no avail though. Posting up with that right arm is Edward.
Nice entry into the takedown. Let's see if Zhang can finish here. Edward's got heavy hips. He's been working hard on his takedown defense. But Zhang is easily able to pass into mount once things hit the ground. Zhang's got heavy hips, good ground and pound. Edward's got to be careful trying to sit up like that.
Zhang, who gets most of his wins on the mat with ground and pound or submissions, also has a background in sanda.
At least in these early stages, Edward has to control the head of Zhang Liping because Zhang likes to posture up and drop ground and pound. Edward did a good job of getting that underhook on the left side, but he has to use both arms to prevent the ground and pound of the left hand of Zhang Liping because he's so heavy with that ground and pound.
Edward's so famous in the Philippines Dragon and so much media attention on everything he does. Would it have been draining this entire week to have, you know, the media continually questioning if this was going to be his last contest and if he was going to retire after tonight if he lost?
You know, like he's like I told you at the Awak, man, he's very comfortable with it. Like he's, I know he might be on a bit of a slide right now, but he still has that same fire and determination. You know, his quote said it all. He says, when people are doing nothing, they want you to join them. And he says that he's very conditioned for this matchup. He knows exactly what Zhang's going to be doing. And he's, you can see that from this sort of defense that he's got. He knows where Zhang is strong. He's just got to be careful defending this overall aggression coming from Zhang Liping right now.
Left hands here from Zhang.
See, he needs to get the underhook on this side so he can get over onto his right side and start to create a little bit of space and movement. But Zhang is using his left arm to drop ground and pound. So Edward is forced to frame off and try to cover, which is an interesting strategic decision from Zhang Liping to keep him in this position and utilize the ground and pound. He's so good at punching into advancing his position. So he will hit you, get you thinking about the ground and pound, and then advance his position like he just did. Edward's trying to turtle now, trying to, Zhang's gonna take his back.
Oh, not good here for Edward. Figure four around the body from Zhang. Edward needs to defend with 80 seconds remaining in the opening round here. Aggressive start from Zhang Liping.
Good control right here from Zhang. You can see that that's what Edward has to do. Edward has to get his body to the foot side so it takes away some of that squeeze. As long as Edward's body is into the knee side of that body triangle, it's going to be hard for Edward to break this and get out of this position. So he needs to try to get his weight over onto that foot so that some of that pressure can be relieved and he can start to work his way out.
Maybe just a small cut on the hairline. On the right side there of Edward Flyang, nothing to worry about, still stuck in this figure four. Zhang continues to apply the pressure. Can he find a finish with 30 seconds remaining in the round? Don't forget we are scored as an overall contest, not round by round.
Edward's doing a good job of defending the submission, but he's getting beat up with the ground and pound. I think because of all the work that he's been doing with the submission defense,
Ben-Sikin.
He hasn't been able to really progress in his attacking ability. He's got to try to spin. He has to try to spin, but all that pressure is on the knee side of the figure four. So you can see that Zhang is just trying to slowly inch forward and close that distance. I like Edward throwing the kicks, but I'd like to see him be a little bit more active with the hands, especially his right. He's got a beautiful right hand, and he can use it to do some damage. But he has to stop this oncoming pressure from Zhang, because Zhang made it very clear in the first round what he wants to do. He wants to get in tight, close that distance, look for a takedown.
This is most people's vote for the most heated division in all of ONE, the lightweights. Christian Lee, the dominant champion. Davy Aslanaliev, Aoki, Ok Rae Yoon, Yuri Lapikus, Timofey Nastukin, the top five. Good leg kick there from Falayan. Overhand right from Zhang, counter uppercut, bolo punch off the right there from Edward. Good evasion from Zhang.
Yeah, Zhang's starting to understand that those leg kicks are going to be a significant weapon of Edward. What does Edward do? Edward mixes things up and goes back to the hands. I like that. Keep coming forward with that 1-2 just to keep Zhang's pressure off.
37 years old, Edward Falaya says he is not done yet.
See, Edward's letting himself get backed up to the wall like that. You can't do that with Zhang. He's just too good on that blast double. Immediately, he gets nice and tight, shoots right in for the takedown, and ends up in half guard. He's going to try to keep Edward flat and then look to pass his guard, or maybe he might just stay here in half guard and do the ground and pound like he did in the first round.
If Edward wants to be in title contention, if he wants to go after the gold held by Christian Lee, he's got to start to put the foot down now. Halfway point of this contest.
But this is a good spot for him to be in, up against that wall. If he can use that wall to start working his way back up, but Zhang's utilizing his right arm to peel him off of the wall so Edward can't use it to stand back up. Edward's got butterfly hooks where his legs are on the inside of the legs there. Yeah, and he was able to push off and create that space. Good job by Edward to work his way back up to his feet.
You know, we talk about Zhang Limping coming in here with huge raps, and he had big raps on himself as well. You know, Mitch, he believes he is ready now for Christian Lee.
Yeah, that's what he told me. He says that after this matchup, he wants Christian Lee, but I think it's really going to be a good litmus test to see how well he's going to transition into ONE Championship. You know, Edward Fuliang has competed against everybody, literally everybody inside ONE Championship. So it's going to be a good sort of measuring stick to see how well he's going to do here. And so far, he is passing this test.
Mitch, that's just going to be confidence and trying to, you know, psych yourself up, because you look at the way that Christian Lee has dismantled every opponent he's faced recently. I mean, he has just taken people apart easily.
Yeah, since moving up to lightweight, Christian Lee has been on another level. But I do like that front punt kick that Zhang's doing. It's really coming right up the middle and snapping the head back of Fuliang. Let's see if Fuliang can defend the takedown here. Ooh, I like the way Zhang spun to the back there, but Edward was wise to it and pushed his back up against the wall so Zhang couldn't spin around and fully take it.
1 minute remaining, second round of three. Edward with the wrist of Zhang. Now Zhang breaks off, trips back to center circle.
Better round for Edward. These last 5 minutes or so, you've seen Edward's been able to get up twice, stop two takedowns, and he's looking better. I think he's just got to land a bit more significant strikes. Because of the lead that Zhang built up in the first 5 minutes, we're starting to see that Edward's working his way back into it by landing some of these shots and also defending the takedowns. That scores.
Action! Mitch, you've seen the evolution of Edward Falayang from ONE Championship ONE 10 years ago to today. What's the biggest change you've seen over the years to Edward?
It's definitely his wrestling. Like, we've always seen, like, I remember back in 2010, you know, Edward has always demonstrated, you know, this type of wushu style striking, but it's his ability to wrestle. This is
This is an improved Edward forehand. Look at that. Stopping the takedown now. That's what happens when you shoot a blind takedown on Edward. He's going to see it coming. Edward's kind of got that number. So Zhang needs to, you know, get back to what he did well. I'd like to see that aggression coming with the hands, getting Edward back, shooting in the middle like this on these blind takedowns. Edward's going to see that coming, and he's going to stop it.
Leg kick from Edward Falaya in the traditional Team Lakai red trunks. He has been the big brother of the Team Lakai camp for so long. He's the one they all look up to, all the guys. Joshua Pascio, and Kevin Bellignon, and Honorio Benario. All the inspiration. And he won the championship gold. Manny Pacquiao put the belt around him.
Every one of these kicks, Edward's inching his way back into this matchup. The match is judged in its entirety, ladies and gentlemen, not round by round. So we judge it as a whole, as one big matchup.
Now there is instruction again coming from the corner of Zhang. We can't understand. What do you assume they are saying, Dragon?
He's got to apply more pressure. See, this is the range that Edward wants. He wants you standing at distance and then picking you apart with these shots. Throwing the leg kicks, throwing the punches, and that's exactly what he's doing. Here, he's starting to back Edward up against the wall. Oh, nice uppercut landed by Zhang. But Zhang's going to shoot for a takedown as soon as Edward. Yep. Good job, though. But he shot it blind. He didn't set that up with punches. Zhang's best takedowns are when Edward's against the wall and punches are first and then the double leg.
Mitch Chilson, as always, with his crystal ball, working overtime, seeing things before they happen. Edward, with 2:50 remaining, must make a statement tonight. The veteran, the former world champion. So too does Zhang Lingpeng. If Zhang wants to earn the respect of this lightweight division, where Christian Lee is the king, the dominant king, in a division with Dagi and Eddie Alvarez and Ok Rae Yoon and Shinya Aoki, Astukin, monster division. If he wants to be a part of the top five, Zhang needs to send a message. Has he done that so far, though?
He's having a hard time pulling the trigger. I think Edwards kind of earned that respect, especially in the second round, because some of these shots are landing heavy. You can just see the thud that Edward puts into a lot of these shots. Nice little check hook there landed by Zhang as he's coming in.
Now, let's not forget, it wasn't so long ago that Edward Falaya had Eddie Alvarez's number, almost beat him, was a whisker away before he made a cardinal mistake in going to the ground with Eddie. But he almost beat him. A leg kicks, Mitch.
Yeah, it's all about these kicks coming from Edward. You know, he's really able to control the distance and place the match where he wants when he's able to land these shots.
Turning back kick, nicely done there from Zhang Lipeng. Glances up on the big screen inside the Singapore Indoor Stadium. Says we have 1:15 remaining.
This is a very important 75 seconds, Michael. This match is really close at this point. I know Zhang landed a couple of takedowns in the second, like right around that 8 minute or 7 minute mark, and then he had a really good first 5 minutes. But Edward, in the latter half of this match, since about that 9 minute mark, has really just been able to showcase some improved striking, but Zhang's got that pressure. So it's really gonna come down to the, you know, what are the judges looking for? What's catching their eye?
Jab there from Zhang. Hooked to a takedown attempt from Zhang. Nice defense from Edward.
See, better takedown that time because he had a punch to it first. He threw the hook first, and then he went into the takedown. He was able to land it. But that's a huge takedown, Michael. And to land in side control like that.
Could this be the determining factor for Zhang Lipeng? That big takedown to side control. Is it what tips the judges over in his favor? It's going to be close.
10 seconds.
Remember, folks, it is judged as an overall 15-minute contest, not as three individual 5-minute rounds.
And then... Zhang Lipeng!